Okay, I have just included one slide saying the difference between the lexical and dynamic scoping. So this will help you while solving the problems also. So let us see what are the differences. So lexical scope is also known as static scope because it is static in nature. And similarly, the dynamic is during the runtime, we can see all these. So therefore, it is known as dynamic scoping. The basic differences between the lexical and dynamic are in the lexical scope, it will use the nested structure, means based on the structure of your program, based on what you have written in the code, it will decide the scope of any variable. So that will be known at the compile time itself. That's why it is known as static. Okay. So in this, variables refers to the top level environment, means it will always see the current level. If it is not visible in the current level, then it will go to the surrounding level and so on. So that's how it works for the lexical. For the dynamic, what happens is whatever is most recently created activation record, from there it will have to take. So that runtime environment it will be using to access the variables. To get the scope, it is easy in the lexical because you can read your code, you know how you have written the code. So it will be quite easy for you to find the lexical scope. Whereas in the dynamic, the programmer has to analyze all the possible contexts because it will be using the calling sequence. So which procedure has called which procedure, what is the depth of these procedures in the call. So those things are important. And here, as I mentioned, the code is how we have written the code, the text in the code is important. Therefore, you can decide. Whereas in the dynamic, it depends upon how the code is executed. Okay, that's why I am telling about the runtime environment. So during execution, you know how the activation records are active, when it is created, when it is deallocated. These things are important for the dynamic scoping. The structure says here, whereas the runtime stack says about the variable. And in the lexical scope, it is not related to the real-time stack at all because everything can be done in the compile time itself. So it doesn't depend on the real-time stack. Whereas in the dynamic, it is very much depending on the real-time stack rather than the program. Okay. So here in the lexical, you don't have any flexibility, means you have very less flexibility. Means whatever you have written in the code, only that much you can take it, that's all. You don't have much options here. Whereas in the dynamic, as your code executes, accordingly, the flexibility also will be given, what variables are saved into the activation record, how it is saved, all that it depends upon the runtime environment. Okay. And coming to the accessing of the non-local variables, accessing to non-local variables in lexical scope is a little fast because it just uses the nesting structure, that's all. So it will see in the current level, otherwise it will see the surrounding level and so on. So that is little easy and it is fast also. Whereas accessing the non-local variables in the dynamic scoping, it takes more time because it will have to look through the activation record. It has to use the address and go back and see the other activation records also which are active, and from there it has to access. So it will take more time comparatively. And in the lexical scope, we use static coordinates, which I had already mentioned in my previous example. So the fields are same, but how it is computed is a little different. So static coordinates are used, whereas in the dynamic scoping, we use dynamic coordinates. So that previous example, whatever I discussed, maybe you can refer back. Now the differences are very clear. So maybe you can go back and work through that problem. Anyways, at the end, I will give one or two examples. Okay. So remember that for the static or the lexical scoping, we will be using the nesting structure or the structure of your code. And based on that only, the scope of the variables are decided. Whereas in the dynamic scoping, we use the calling sequence or the calling relationship where which function is calling which function and how the activation records are active, that is more important. So based on that only, it will be the coordinates are created. So at some point when something is active only, you'll be able to access those variables, isn't it? So based on that only, it will give the it will maintain the level and the offset. Okay. So let us proceed further. So these are the differences. Now let us see how to access this non-local data at runtime. In my previous topic also, that is the symbol table, we use the lexical scope there also, and we were able to access the variables in the current level, in the previous level, and so on. So we could do that. We could do it easily in case of symbol table, and all that happens in the compile time. So local lookup variable declaration from symbol table, because already I had mentioned for the symbol table to access, you'll be using a function called lookup. So using that lookup function, if the symbol is already entered into the symbol table with the level and number also maintained, it is easy for you to access. So that will make you to access the non-local data also. You can also use these fields, which will help you, because it is not just one level or only one symbol table that is maintained. You have a stack of symbol tables also. Therefore, easily you can find out the values or the attributes of some particular variable by using the level and the offset fields, which is nothing but whatever we maintain in the static coordinates and the dynamic coordinates. So generating that will help you, and this also will be done at compile time because we are dealing with a symbol table. Okay, and now coming to the, suppose I want to do something at the runtime, then what do we do? Then definitely we will have to make use of the concept like the dynamic coordinates. So there also we have the same fields, level and offset, only the way we compute is a little different. But for this, we need separate mechanisms, even though the dynamic coordinates exist, but we need some mechanism to access at runtime. So for that, we'll be using something called, there are two mechanisms, access links and the display. These are the two mechanisms that are used to access non-local data at runtime. At compile time, it is easy because already we have the symbol table maintained. We can make use of the static coordinates and we can get it. Okay, because everything is dependent on your structure of the code, so it is easy. But whenever you want to find at the runtime, then you will have to make use of some mechanisms. So these are the mechanisms which we are going to discuss a little later. So let us see the next topic. Till now, we have completed how the procedure call abstraction is done and how the standard linkages are helpful in calling and returning from the functions and maintaining all the data with respect to the functions at runtime environment that is done. And also we have seen how to manage the namespaces and how do we structure them and how do we maintain and access them. That also to some extent we have done some examples. So now let us see how the communication happens between the procedures and what are the things that are communicated from one procedure to the other procedure when it is called and when it is returned. Okay, so first thing is that we know that concept of procedure is abstraction. We don't have all the details. What are the actions that are performed? Only when you go in depth, you'll know what are the different parameters that are saved, how the address is, return address is saved, how the return value is saved. So these things are happening, and most of the things are in abstract only nature, abstract nature. So in that we have the parameters where you have the caller and the callee. With respect to the caller, whatever parameters have been passed that are known as actual parameters, and whatever parameters are used in the definition of the procedure that is in the callee, we call them as formal parameters. And so definitely there is something passed from the caller to the callee, and that is also an example of the communication between the procedures. So what you communicate to the other procedure when it is called is also a part of communication. Okay, so if the programmer desires, even they can return the result back. So that anyway, that is also one kind of communication. When you call You are passing the parameters and it will be received in the procedure, and it will use those parameters inside the function. That is one thing. And the other thing is that if at all some result has to be returned, that also will be returned back to the function where it was called. Okay. So passing the parameters, we have some conventions. This you would have learned in many programming languages already, this particular concept. So one such concept is, say, call by value, where whenever the caller calls some function, whatever parameters it is going to pass, that is the actual parameters, I'll talk to you later. Actual parameters are evaluated, and those values are passed to the callee. Okay, so whatever values are supposed to be sent as the actual parameters, that are sent in terms of values to the callee, and then any modification that happens inside the callee is not visible to the caller. Okay, any modification that happens in the callee is not visible in the caller, because it is call by value, that is pass by value is happening. Now let us take one example for this call by value. This is a function where you have the function which is having two arguments, x and y, and inside we are doing some computation and we are returning the value of y. So let us take some calls with respect to this function. So first I will take this particular call, c is equal to phi of 2, 3. So once it sends 2 and 3, x is going to get the value of 2 and y is going to get the value of 3, because it is called by value. And inside what happens, x is equal to 2 into 2 will become 4. And then y will be 4 plus 3, it will become 7, and the return value will be 7. Okay, so for this particular call, this is going to be the result. Okay, this is one thing. This is done now. Second call is that I initialize the variable with the same names, like whatever I had sent in the previous case, the same thing we will send. A is equal to 2, I will assign, and B is equal to 3. And now I will make a call by sending A and B as parameters. So now A and B are the actual parameters, and x and y will become the formal parameters. And now still x and y value will be 2 and 3, because a and b values have been already sent and the answer will not change. So let us see, I will show in the table how it is going to reflect in terms of a and b also. So for the first one, I have not used any variables for the first call, that is c is equal to phi of 2, 3. A and b variables are not used, so in and out. So once it is entered into the function, and when it is exit from the function, there is nothing about A and B, and only the result can be returned for the first call. And suppose I have something like this phi of A comma B with some initial values of A and B as 2 and 3. So the entry point, it will be 2 for A. And what about the value for A at the exit? It remains the same, because whatever happens inside the function phi is not visible to the caller. So in and out for A will be 2 only. Similarly, in and out for B also will be 3 only. Even though I receive it as x as 2 and y as 3, inside the function we are doing some computation, but that is not reflected for A and B. And the answer is also same, because we have sent the same values. Okay, so that is about the second call. About the third call, again, A is equal to 2 and B is equal to 3. And this is the third call. Third call is, we are sending the parameters as A comma A only, not B. So now what happens? This will be 2. So it will receive Y also as 2 now. And based on that, the values are computed. So 2 into 2 will be 4 only, so that will not change. And 4 plus 2 will be now 6. And this return value will be 6. how the variable values are visible, we will see for the third call, A entry point and exit point, it is same value. For B, anyway, I have not used. Then also the value of B will remain the same at the entry and the exit. And now the final answer is based on the computation inside the function, and that is 6. Okay, so like this, it works. So at the exit point, there is nothing reflected because inside whatever happens, it is only with respect to the function, not for the caller. So for caller, it remains the same. So that's about the call by value. Now, yes.
Ma'am, let us say inside P function, we have one more variable X, int X. So will it vary in terms of lexical or dynamic scoping, or since both have the same scope values?
See, whatever is recently done, only that value only will be remaining in the variable. Suppose if you maintain X, no. See, X can be used at different statements, right? Whatever is recently done, that value only will be saved because you are overwriting.
Yes, whether it's static or dynamic. We have two meanings. Like in dynamic scoping, we use the term recently done, and in lexical we use the term like how recently it is declared. So which recently are we taking?
Yes. So anyway, I'm now worried about the value, right? Whatever is recently updated only will be taken, isn't it? Inside the function I'm seeing. Once you come out, that it will return, and then that will affect. For dynamic scoping, no, this is not a good example. Why do you know? It is only like I am not having the continuous calls here. It is just one call, first call, second call, like that I am doing. If I am calling recursively, then yes, that will affect. You have to see that. Or I have many functions called in the sequence, then also it will be effective. Otherwise, the static and dynamic work similarly, isn't it? Because I don't have much calls here. So when you have more calls, then only it will make sense for the dynamic, because you'll be creating the series of activation records. Now, what has happened from the main, I would have called one function and only one record for main and one record for the function would exist. That's it. So not much difference whether you have to see in the current function. If it is not available, then you have to see the next scope, that is in the main. There also it doesn't exist. Then you have to see the global. That's it. Not much actually. So it is very similar then. So only when you have too much of nested structure, too much of calls, then the difference is seen between the static and dynamic. Anyway, in both the cases, like in the static, what you see is in the current level you see and the next level you see, like that you go. What happens in the dynamic is you see the current, that is the callee function you'll see. If it is not available, then its parent you have to see. Its parent means where it was called. So callers, ARP, you are going to see. Then that also is not visible. It's caller you are going to see. Like that it goes. That's it. That's the only difference. Otherwise, it's the same. The strategies are same. Only thing is in the lexical, you use the nested structure. In the dynamic, you use the calling structure. That's it. Got it? For this example, I wanted to give about the how the call by value works. That's all. I'm not taking that much complexity in the example. If you take the complex code, yes, you can see the difference, isn't it?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah. I will take such example at the end. I will finish everything and we'll combine some concepts, and then I will give some example. Okay. That will be better. Okay, so proceeding with the next convention is call by reference. A convention, in this particular convention, what happens is, instead of passing the value, we pass the address for the formal parameter to the callee, and therefore whatever is reflected in that address, that will be seen by the caller also. So it is reflected. Whatever modification you make, that is seen to the caller also. Actually, we say it is nothing but aliasing, means aliases. Whatever names we are creating, no, for the formal parameters, they are known as aliases, because they will be using the same storage location. So any changes you make, that will be reflected and it can be seen. So let us take a similar example, but we'll be using the call by reference now. Procedure is similar actually, and the computation is also similar, but let us see when we make three different calls for the same function, what happens. We will see. First we will take this C is equal to phi of 2, 3. There is not much change because we are sending the values itself, and there won't be any effect. X will take the value of 2 and Y will take the value of 3, and that's it. So not much here. But when you use a variable, what happens? There is not much difference. Whatever computation it will do, and it will return the answer. But when you use a variable, when I use the variable, say A, this is done now. I will show in the table later. A is equal to 2 and B is equal to 3 is what we have assigned. And we are making this call. Now, once you call like this, it will take the address of A, it will take the address of B. So A has been allocated somewhere in some address, and B also has been allocated in some address. And at the address of A, what is saved is, it is 2. And at the address of B, what is saved is 3. Okay. Now, even though the values for X and Y are 2 and 3, but it will be using the same location as A and B, corresponding to A and B. So some address, some address say 100, something like that. I will not use the consecutive locations now, just like that I'm using say 100 and 200 for A and B. Suppose if I use like this, X and Y will be using the same location. Okay, so therefore the value associated with X and Y also will be 2 and 3 now, right now, once it is sent. So and inside the function, what happens now? X is equal to 2 into X is what we are computing. So it will become 4. It will become 4. And Y will become 4 plus 3. It will become 7. And then it is going to return 7. Okay. So what is the value of X now? It will become what? It will become 4. What will be the answer for Y? It will become 7. Finally, after the computation, this is what it is going to reflect. So now what happens, we'll see in the table itself. So for the first call, there is not no difference because we are sending the values directly. It is not using any variable storage location. So it will just take the constant value and it will compute. So it is same like a call by value. Whereas for the variables, when we use, definitely it has been allocated. And you see the difference in value for A is what, 2. That's what I took in the beginning. And then once it is computed, X value changes and both are using the same location. Therefore, as X changes, A also at the exit point, it will have 4. Okay. Similarly, for B, initially we had taken 3 as the initial value. And once it exits from the function, B value also will be affected because it corresponds to Y. Therefore, it is 7 and the return result is also 7. So that's about the second call. So coming to the third call is what we are making this call now. It is A and A. Anyway, I am not worried about this now. So A will be. A will be 2. And remember that X is received as the value 2, and because we are passing the same parameter, this also will be 2. So X and Y both will use the same location now, as good as A, also using the same location. And now coming to the computation, it will be with respect to the values that have been received in those locations, and therefore what happens now? X is equal to 2. This will be 4 only. Yeah, of course, it is 4 only. And then, so this becomes 4 now. This becomes 4. And then Y is equal to X plus Y. So it is, what happens here is, it will be 4 plus. What is Y? Y is also 4 because X and Y are sharing the same location. So Y plus X plus Y, that is 4 plus 4 will become 8. So this will become 8 now, okay? Because both are using the same location. And you see how the in and out works. So at entry point for A, it was 2. And then at exit point, because A is also using the same location, it becomes 8. And for B, there is no change because I never used B. Okay, I didn't use B for this particular call. And the return result is 8. Okay, so for B, maybe you can imagine it's the same thing. It is the same thing, but now Y is not associated. That's all. So B will have the same 3, but Y we are not associating and we are not using that value also in that particular call. So B remains the same. Whereas A initially it was 2, and because of the changes inside the function, it has reflected and it becomes 8. So that's how it works. So call by reference is very much essential in most of the situations because we wanted to see the results after the function call, and that is reflected easily. And if it is useful in the remaining part of the program, then definitely it helps. Okay. So it depends upon the requirement of the user or the programmer, how you want to use, whether call by reference or call by value. Based on that, you'll be using the calls also accordingly. So that is about the passing parameters. So this examples I gave, why? Because there is the communication happening between one procedure to the other procedure. So when I call some function, something is passed, like either by call by value or call by reference. Similarly, what else is passed? Definitely, there are two more things that are passed. That is the return address and the return value. Once a function is called, you know that if it has to resume back the execution from the next statement onwards, then the return address is very important. So return address is also maintained and it will be passed. So as the activation records are created, this return address is also saved into that particular record, or it can be maintained in a separate register. A series of return addresses can be maintained in the register. In some languages, like some architecture supports that, but otherwise also for every activation record, the return address is maintained. Okay, so that is pushed onto the stack or it can be maintained in the register. And similarly, if at all the results are computed and if it has to be returned from the function every time, this return value is also placed into the register. Maybe only once means it can be placed in the register, or there are more calls, then it can be returned. Wherever it has been called, from there it will return. Maybe if I give some statement accordingly, it will save the value into that particular variable. So that also is an example for the communication between the procedures, because it is returning from one procedure to the other procedure. And finally, wherever the initial call was made, it will return the value to that particular statement. And if at all it is used maybe for printing or in any other operation, that can be used. Okay, so return address and return value is also a part of communication between the procedures. So now coming to how do we manage to get the addresses for different areas in our code. Okay, so one such area is, in the last class I had given the classical organization of the different sections, like code area, then data area, then static variables, global variables, and then stack, then heap. I had given one organization. So similar organization is assumed now also. Coming to the data area is nothing but the region in memory that holds the data for the specific scope. So we can have the static data, we can have the global data, we can have the data related to the activation records that is maintained in the stack for some lifetime, that is still it is active. And also we can make use of heaps where the lifetime is extended. So these things are required. But for all these, some address is required. So how do I access this data then? So whatever variables, local variables I have saved, whatever return address I have saved, whatever return result I have saved, all these need to be accessed. So how do we do that then? We need the address for it. And that's what we are going to use, the base address concept, where it gives the starting address of the data area. From there onwards, if you want to access any other thing, you can use the correct offset. Means when once you get the base address, like how you use the base address for an array and then you access a particular element in the array, similar to that you can do it here also. You can have the address calculation by taking the base address and you can take the scope of that particular variable in that area, and then you can also compute the offset based on the size of the variables or whatever. So you use the offset and then finally you can find the address of a particular variable. That's why we are maintaining the level and the offset, because if you know the level, if you have the base address for that particular level, you can easily access any element in that particular area. So that's how it works. So you need the base address and you need the correct offset. This can be done using two kinds of addresses. That is the static base address and the dynamic base address. Static base address means, as the name itself says, it is static in nature. You know, everything fixed. At the compile time itself, you can compute and keep it ready. So that is what it means. And if it is dynamic base addresses, then at runtime, many things will happen that you will have to take care. And many languages support the allocation at the runtime. So based on that, you'll be using or you'll be computing the base addresses and the corresponding offset. Okay, so let us see how it is done. Whenever you have some kind of data like static data and the global data, they are much similar. In the previous slides, if you go back and see, I have explained global and static data, they work similarly. It means you know in advance at the compile time itself, what are the things, what are the variables you have, how many variables you have, what data type it is, how much size you have for an array or whatever you have used, that you know at compile time. Okay, so it will be easy for you to compute the offset, and using the base address, you can just access that particular element or the variable. So to generate the address for such variable, what we do is we compute the base address into the register. So we can, because many architectures will support load kind of instructions. So what you can do is you can load the base address into some register, or maybe a designated register will have the base address. From there, you can add the offset to that base address and you can compute. So that way you can find the address for any particular element. And there is something called mangling the name. This concept is used for the base address. What you do is when you have the base, when you use some name, like label one, I use, then I will use label two, label three, something like that we use. That is actually programmer is using like that, similar names we are using. Even the compiler uses the similar kind of concept where some name is there, means you'll just add the prefix or suffix or both sometimes. Just to create a new name, what you do is you use the name, but you add something into it to the original name. This will really help, because this concept is known as mangling the name. And this will help because maybe you can use the same base address, and these labels are created at different offsets. The base address can be same and the offsets can be different. So it will be easy for us to maintain and organize the data in the memory, and accessing will become easy. If at all you have some variable name, say fee, and if you want to take the address of this fee and put it into register, some instruction like this can be used. Load and the corresponding addressing mode also can be selected. Like if I want to use some constant value, then I go with the immediate addressing mode. So ampersand fee means it will take the address and it will save it into the register, say RI. So like this, we can move the address into the register. And now the address is available in RI. I can make use of this address. If that is a base address, then it is easy for me. For the next variable, or if it is in the contiguous location, I can easily find the offset for the next variable, next to next, and so on. So that becomes easy. So whenever you are using the name, you can add the prefix or suffix or both sometimes. And maybe you can treat it as a block in such a way that the base address can be common and the offset can vary. So that concept can be used for the global and the static data areas. Okay, so let us see more about this. In some languages like Fortran, the language collects the global variables into common blocks. That's what I was telling. So if at all you make it in a common block, what happens? The advantage is you can have the common base address, and also whatever comes in the same scope, that if you put together, it will be easy for you. If you allocate together, it will be easy for you to access. So that's why we have introduced that level number into consideration, and then using that, it becomes easy to differentiate between the scope at level 1 or level 2 or level 3, so that the data areas are made in such a way that it is easy for us to access. Okay, so there may be some conflicts because most of the time we'll be using the names repeatedly, reusing the names repeatedly. Therefore, whenever you want to have the visibility, then the scope is important. The scope is important because we are trying to reuse the names. At different levels, the same name is used. So you have to take the scope, and then only you can avoid the conflicts. Otherwise, what happens? The compiler will have confusion which value to use. Okay, we are telling manually, but analytically it is fine, theoretically it is fine, but practically it has to take the correct value. Therefore, it is very important to maintain the level number and the offset, so that if I know the level, then I have the base address, and if I know the offset, I can go to that offset and I can get that variable and the corresponding attributes, maybe the value or any other, like address also. Sometimes we track the address, we track some other attribute in the symbol table. Those things can be easily accessed. Okay, so the advantage is, as I mentioned, you can reduce the number of base addresses in use. So for every variable, you don't have to create new base address. This is the advantage. And also it will reduce the demand for the registers. So once you create the base address, what you are doing is you are placing that particular base address into a register. Now I can just make use of this register. So I have to add, suppose my offset is say 10, this base address plus 10, I can do that. And some other element is present at some location, say 60th location, then this base address plus 60. So it is very easy to find the address for any particular variable. So that's how it is an advantage. Let us see whether any other methods are there to handle this. For static base addresses, this is the best way to do. You can put it in the common blocks for the global data and the static data, and you can use the common base address, and you can reduce the number of registers required, and that's how it is an advantage. Okay, now coming to the variables that are created at a dynamic, that is at the runtime, then the dynamic base addresses have to be computed. Okay, so maintaining the static base address is very easy because you know everything at compile time. So you can pre-compute and keep it ready. And whenever it is essential, you can bring it to the register and you can perform the operation, desired operation. That is much easy. Whereas when you have the dynamic base addresses, then dynamic base addresses are existing. Why? Because at the runtime only, I know how many calls have been made, and how the activation records are created, what is saved into the activation record, what are the limitations of this activation records, whether it is visible to that particular caller or the callee. Those things are important now. Okay, so managing this needs some extra effort, and therefore we use some mechanisms for finding the dynamic base addresses. Okay, so in order to do that, what we do is we can have some common mechanisms to communicate between the procedures. As I mentioned, we were having the call by reference or call by value or returning the value or saving the return address. These things we can easily manage by using two kinds of mechanisms. Those are access link and the display. Access link, we have two types of access link. One is the static link that tells about the nesting structure, that is the nested scoping. And we have another type which is known as the dynamic link, which says about the dynamic scoping. So overall, I can say static link deals with the static coordinates and dynamic link deals with the dynamic coordinates. And because we are using the lexical scope in the static, so it will deal with the nesting relationship. Whereas in the dynamic link, we will be using the calling relationship. So here the link points to the enclosing parent frame pointer or ARP. ARP stands for activation record pointer. And for the dynamic link, what we use is we need the calling sequence. Definitely it will have to access through the caller's frame pointer. Okay, caller's frame pointer. So here the nesting is used, here the calling sequence is used. Accordingly, we are differentiating between the static link and the dynamic link, like how we differentiated between the static coordinates and the dynamic coordinates. So this is one way of solving the problem, that is how to communicate between the procedures. And the other way is using an array called global display array. And using that also, it is possible to manage the communication between the procedures. So let us see some things about the access link. Anyway, everything I cannot complete in today's class. Whatever I can complete, I'll complete. So access links is basically, we have two types of access link, right? So a compiler ensures that whenever the activation record is created, if you remember the structure of the activation record, because I taught it long back, so I will just go back and show once the structure so that you recall it. Okay, this is the structure. Sorry for that. Yes, this is the structure. Maybe I can show in detail. This one. So this is the structure of the activation record. You see, for every activation record, something called ARP is maintained. Okay, so it will maintain that address. So it will have the link to the caller's ARP. This is important. Okay, so this is what I am telling. So every time when the activation record is created, ARP is also pointing to that address. And therefore, that we are going to use now. That we are going to use now for the access link. Okay. So we have the pointer, and it is known as static link if at all you are using the nesting structure. And it will form a chain of the access links, because it is not that you are only accessing the current level data. If it is not available or if it is not declared in the current level, then you will have to go to its surrounding level. And if it is a static or if it is dynamic, then you have to see the caller and its caller and so on. So it is nothing but it is having a chain, and it will have the lexical ancestors from the current procedure. So, but anyway, you can have the access by using the scope. So any local variable of another procedure is visible to the current procedure if it is stored in the AR. And using the chain of access links, you'll be able to get it. So it's like level one, I have, then level two, then level three. In the level three, it will check if it is not possible. Then it will have to go to the level two. So you have a link there. You have an access link going to the next level. And all the way it will go to level zero also, because if nothing is available, it will see if nothing is available, then it don't have that value entered or that variable entered. If it is available, then it will be able to look up for that, and it will take it. So it is forming a chain of access links, and then finally you can go to that particular point where that particular variable exists and you can access that. So that's how it works. Means this is what I call it as access links chain. So level two, if the current variable is at level two, and if I want to access at level two, then I am in the current location itself, that is in the current level itself. I can make use of the current access link, and then I can get the answer. If it is not present in the level two, then I will have to access from the level one. It will check through the level one, and if it is not available, then it will go to the level zero. It is like that. So it forms a chain of access links. Okay. So one example we can take maybe I will take this in the next class. I will just tell how the static coordinate or dynamic coordinates are going to be helpful. Suppose I am at level two. M is two. That is the current level. And imagine that this particular address, whatever address of ARP that is saved in some designated register, say RARP, like this, RARP. Okay, this contains the address of the ARP, that is the activation record pointer. And now I am at level two. If I want to access some data at a different level, what happens? Or at the same level, what happens? First, I will give the example of at the same level. So if I take the coordinate, say 2,24. So 2 is what this gives the level number. What is 24 then? 24 is nothing but the offset. So at level 2 and with the offset 24, I need the data of that particular variable. So this is nothing but some variable exists. Okay, for that variable, I'm using the coordinate. So for this coordinate, what is the answer I can get, or how do I access that particular variable? It is by using the load instructions. So only for the first case I'll cover today. Other two cases I'll cover in the next class. So load AI, what happens? Load add immediate. So already I know that ARP address is present in the register, that is RARP. And I am at level 2. And also I want to access the variable that is at the same level. So I don't have to go to some other level now or some other particular symbol table. Okay, so I'll be accessing the same table. Therefore, are the same activation record, same symbol table or same activation record. Sometimes we call it as activation record. Sometimes we will be accessing the symbol table. Symbol table access is also similar. That's why I'm giving both. Okay, so RARP contains what? The address now. Address, and in that from that address, I have to reach to the value of where the offset is 24. Right. So offset is 24 means at level 2, 24 means for the base address, I have to add this 24. So whatever I get, that will become the address, and that you can copy to the register, say R2. So now the address is available at R2. So if I access the contents of that particular address, I will get the attribute or the value, whatever I wanted. Okay. So like this, we can access. So for current level, both the levels are same. That is, I am at level 2 and I am also accessing at level 2 means it is easy. If I am at different level and my data is in different level, then some things have to be done. For that, you need more load instructions that I will discuss in the next class maybe, because I should not do it in a hurry. So I will do it slowly. This example, I will continue in the next class. Okay, students, if you have any doubts, you can ask. Otherwise, I think already it's time.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.